Chinese landscape paintings frequently puzzle Western observers. They seem to be so bare, so simple. A jutting crag, tumbling waterfall, a brook flowing out of the unlimited distance, a simple tree overhanging the brook. And between and around the objects lie vast spaces, unbroken stretches of uniform background, out from which these few powerful hills, or singing brooks, or rhythm-filled trees project. Can it be that the Chinese artists have only rudimentary skill and artistic sense, and can proceed no further in their paintings? Did they not know how to fill the surface to full? Yet critics tell us they are the world's masters of landscape. There is a profundity and subtlety in such pictures which we should not miss. Such painting carries the universe in its bosom. It sets forth the infinite, the everlasting background, and the source of all things, and shows us the finite particulars as outputting revelations of that source itself. Out of it they came. Back into it they shall retire. So there is no disconnection. The finite is a fragmentary disclosure of the infinite, a rhythm-filled continuation of that unspeakable full life which gives it birth. There's no barrenness in these pictures, for those open spaces are the fullest part of the scene. Space surrounds and embraces the rock, the wind-moved tree in its tender and its mighty clasp. It extends behind all objects as their common background. All spaces are one space. All things have a final environment and mother. So sit before a painting of a few bamboos, a few joints that are resolved here and there, and out of the undifferentiated background, it becomes enough. One worships. One cannot ask for more. The open spaces are an analog, a parallel, to the silences in a meeting for worship. These too are too full for articulate expression. The glory and the fullness of the infinite can only be portrayed by the unbroken silence. Unhurried, unharried, we feel our way back to the world's mother, as a child feels its way to its parents' arms. And there, the unspeakable is enough, fuller than all expostulations and assurances. And yet, again and again, from out of the background emerge words, outthrusts of the divine life, a few sentences uttered in time, yet pronounced in eternity. A daily matter becomes set in a cosmic frame. Resumption of silence is but the continuation of a deeper silence. The unbroken space that extends behind crag and cascade and river. To crowd the canvas full with finite figures, that is a calamity indeed. That would be to miss the most important part of the picture. We live in a secularized culture. And what does that mean? It means that we do crowd the canvas full. We leave no room for the infinite. And the daily affairs become just that, daily affairs. No awareness of the background of the infinite. The primrose by the river's bank becomes just a primrose. There is no room for wonder, for glory, for worship. In the secular mind, a saint is a collection of atoms, and the cross becomes an expression for fear and hate. Life, outthrusting, inbreathing, self-revealing, could fill our day's experience and give it a cosmic sweep and dignity. But The secular mind of our day lacks depth. It lacks that dimension whereby the finite is bound to the infinite. We crowd the canvas of our lives full. We must keep the radio going, hurry away to the movies, to the next committee meeting, or hunt for conversation. Fidget till we find three more for bridge. Lawrence Binion, in his Spirit of Man in Asian Art, says, "We Westerners are afraid of space, of all-filling, all-embracing space, for it is awe-filled, awe-inspiring. It engulfs us all, but we dare not be aware of it. We cover it over with the near, the local, the detailed, and filling the canvas with such, we say there's no infinite background when we've blotted it out. The secular mind is too much with us as individuals and as a culture. And now and again, one finds a life so lived that its daily deeds are set in a frame of eternity. There is a spaciousness about such a life, majestic space in its aura. Unhurried and sure, it breathes forth out of the everlasting. The odor of the ageless is upon it. By its serenity, we are shamed and recalled. Shuddering and quieted, we turn again home. Like personality ringed by eternity, silence in worship has a gigantic meaning. Like the Chinese landscape, it portrays the infinite and its relation to the finite, the unspoken and the unspeakable, and its relation to the spoken and to thought. It is an acted drama of the true nature of things, of man and God. It is the antithesis of the secular mind. It holds the secret of reality in itself, that secret after which a semi-disconnected, semi-disillusioned secularity is seeking, yet knows not what it seeks. For it restores wonder, glory, radiance, worship, the deepest response of human beings to the deepest secrets of God and of His world.